ארצי נפשי אס השם. טרקטט שבת, פייג' 15. Today we're going to study two different aspects. One is a little history. We're going to learn about the procession of the delivery of the Torah. We're also going to learn Hilchot Tum'ah and Tahara. If you remember yesterday, I mentioned to you that there are two phases of learning it. One phase is here and there are some applications in our time. And you see yesterday an example, our discussion over Hafrashat Chala, taking a portion of the Chala. But there is another phase we said yesterday, which is, it's called Lefum Tza'ara Agra, which means sometimes you learn something and you feel what this has to do with my life. But I remember many years ago when I said to my Rebbe, when you study the little difficult subject of red heifer and Tuma and Tahara, and I asked him what this has to do with my life as a young teenager, and he said to me, and I'm just speaking in the language that we will understand, let's say if you attend a class and you enjoy it and you learn a lot, so in that sense, okay, Hashem give you a reward, let's say $100. But if it's very difficult, it's cold outside, and you made it an effort to come to the class 6 in the morning like we are doing here, and you really sit in the class and your level of understanding is limited, and then you watch on YouTube and you understand better, and then you send me an email and you get better, but still you don't feel that you grasp it fully and you struggle, in our language God give you $5,000 instead of $100. So lefum tzara agra, sometimes as hard as it is, the greatest is the reward and the mitzvah. And yes, we're not doing things for reward, but it gives you it elevates you to be attached to Hashem in a highest level, and also it grants you things that you're not even aware of. That's part of what we believe. So now we going to our subject itself. The first one is a continuation of Shmona Asar Davar. 15, four lines from the top of the page. Gufa amar Rav Huna, בשלושה מקומות נחלקו בית שמאי והלל. Review what we studied in the past 2 days. It was Aliyat Hananya ben Chizkiah. And they learned 18 different things. And we explained that it was two phases of the 18. Some said, some Rishonim hold that, like Rashba and Ramban, they said that 18 decree they made by Beit Shammai, and 18 other things they didn't make a decision. It's not clear if it's 18 as a final or 18 and 18. Now, Hillel and Shammai themselves, as a leader, as individual, only in 3 places they disagree. Again, that's Hillel and Shammai. It's not the 18 at this point. He goes to tell us what we said just earlier, that it was Aliyat Hananya ben Chizkiah. It was a spa that Hananya ben Chizkiah, the fellow we mentioned, the great sage, that dedicate his time to explain the book of Ezekiel. So they went to visit him, and it was at that time the student of Shammai was the majority, and student of Hillel, they accepted that. They accept Achra'at Adin, and they agreed. So that's the 18. But Rav Huna tells us here that it was specifically 3 places that Beit Shammai, the Hillel himself, Hillel Shammai, argued. Which are they? So this is not just here, it's also in Mishnah. in Tractate Adayot, if you remember last year we studied Mishnayot, that's in the Tractate Adayot, so already now refreshing what we studied last year. Shammai Omer, Shammai said, Mikav Chala. Rashi explained to us that we have to have a Hafrashat Chala. Imagine you have a dough, and if you remember all the time I go to the kitchen when whoever in the kitchen committee preparing Chala for Shabbat, and I make sure before they do anything, they do Hafrashat Chala, which is they're taking a tie, they're taking a slice of dough, and they put it aside and burn it. Why are they doing that? Originally speaking, at the time of Beit HaMikdash, it was 24 special gifts that was given to the Kohen, which means, as you know, they divided the land, and each tribe they get their own. And some owns property and some owns businesses. The Kohanim are the servant. They are in the Beit HaMikdash, in the Holy Temple. And they are supported by the community, by the tribes. So one of the Torah obligations is to give a 24 different gifts to the Kohen. If you remember several days ago, we talked about certain part of the animals when you're slaughtering, you need to give them. One phase of that is when you preparing the challah, you're preparing the dough, you have to take a slice of that and give it to the Kohen. Okay, so that's a kol hafrashat challah. The question is, how much a person need to slice for the Kohen? Since the Torah use a word that it's not absolute clear cut. They use, for example, soon we discuss the word hin. So we said that the rabbis instituted and said as follows. When you need to do that, you need to go by a special nefach, which means you take the dough and you measure. You have to know that the dough is different between when it's just you bought it or you bake it or you prepare it versus when it's puff up. It's a different measurement. So the question is, how you measure it? You measure it by the way that it's already done, or it's the while before you prepare. So they said, we start with the measure of beitza. If you remember, in many places in the Shas, in the Talmud, we have beitza, which is egg. That's the size of the middle chicken egg. It's not here the measure, I just give you the stages in order to understand how much is the challah. So imagine you have a middle size of egg, of beitza. And now the next size in the measurement, it's called log. Log, what is log? Log, it's six eggs, which means if you take six eggs, put that measurement together, again, this is the Talmudic time measurement, this call log. Or there is another word to call it, it's called 1/4, rova hakav, 1/4 of the kav. Why? And now it's key point. You have to remember, it's called kav. Kav, kuf, bet, it's basically four logim. What does that mean? If you tell me that log, it's six eggs, so how much is a kav?
24 eggs.
Excellent, Gil. Proud of you. 24 eggs. So that's very important. Why it's very important? Because Shammai tells us from the point of Kav, which is in parentheses, how much? We just said it, is 24 eggs. That's what's called Shi'ur Chiyuv Be'afrashat Chala. That's the obligation to take a tithe from Chala, which is 24 egg. That's the measurement, which means any type of dough that carry a measurement of kav, which is 24 eggs, according to Shammai, a person who owns it, a person who bake it, need to put a slice for the Kohen as hafrashat chala, as a tightening the dough. Vehilel omer, Hilel hold, mikabayim. No, that's too much. You're asking a person from the size of kav, 24 eggs, it's really too much. What we asking? It's the ask of shnei kavim, two kavs. So what did Hillel said? How much you need to slice? 24, two times, it's 48. So far what we understand, the difference between Shammai and Hillel, Shammai hold one kav, 24 eggs, Hillel hold two kabim, 48 eggs. So Hillel hold, much lenient, that only from the measurement of two kabim, 48 eggs, that's the amount that one needs to give to the Kohen as a hafrashat chala. V'chachamim omrim. And the sages enter to this domain of disputation between Shammai and Hillel, and they said, Lo chedivrei ze, velo chedivrei ze, ela kav umechza chayav bechala. So the sages made a compromise, and they make, which we call in math, how do you call it, Dave? You take it in the middle part, right? How do you call it?
Average or mean?
Mean, our average, excellent. So the sages said the measurement is kavu mechza. How much is kavu mechza?
1.5.
Which is? How many eggs?
Would be 36 eggs.
Excellent, it will be 36 eggs. So according to the sages, and by the way, the halacha is according to the sages, is 36. Why? Why they come to 36? Just they want to be nice guys between Hillel and Shammai? No. The answer is because the Torah said in the book of Bamidbar, book of Numbers, chapter 15, they said, Reshit arisoteichem, chala, tarimu, truma lahashem. The Torah said that at the beginning of the Isa, the dough that took from the Omer, which is, again, this is Doh HaMidbar, this is the generation of the desert, and the people wander in the desert, and they have the Omer, you know, the collection of the weaves, right? And you take the dough from that, and that was, you know, the manna, they have the manna, etc. So what do? The Torah said, Omer lagulgolet, for every head you take an Omer, and you have to do asirit ha'efa. Asirit meaning 1/10. So in that time of the Midbar, the desert, it was 18 log. That was 1/10. So since they told the children of Israel while they are in the desert, so arisotechem, it's basically the amount of dough that the children of Israel used to do in the desert, which was Asirit Ha'efaz, 1/10. So the sages said, we will learn it in the future, in Attracted Bikurim, Attracted Eruvin, Pei Gimel 83, the sages said that they took all the measurement, and they come to the conclusion that it's basically Kav Umechza, it's basically a measurement of 36 eggs. Just a side note, the Noda Biuda, he wasn't really happy with that, and he said that the measurement of the Mishnah is not an equivalent to those measurement, and he talked about two different concepts, which I don't want to go there, but I just give you the abbreviation. He called one concept, he called Midot Midbar, a measurement that they did in the ancient time, in the time the Jews went in the wilderness. And the other one is called Midot Yerushalmiyot, the measurement of Yerushalayim, that it's 20% more than the measurement of the midbar. And therefore, it's a different. Rashi here elaborated that, but in short, Midah Yerushalmit, it's different. So here, Amru, Chameshet Reva'im Kemach, Chayavin Bechala. So the sages said that according to the new measurement, so now the five Reva'im of flour is subject to Chala. So Reva'im, it's quarter, just in the simple way. But Rabbi Yossi disagree. Rabbi Yossi Omer, Chamisha, five Reva'im, Pturim, they're exempt from giving Chala, Chamisha ve'ol Chayavim, which means if it's more, then it's different. So just some point. It's all applied mishigdilu amidot, which means that it was in a place in the Galilee. It's called Tzipori, and after the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash, the sages went to North Israel, which is Galilee Tzipori, and for some times it was in that place, the Sanhedrin center part, which means it was the headquarter. And therefore, those measurements, they later in the Tractate Eruvin, Pei Gimel, 83, they call it Tziporiot. That's the measurement of Tziporiot. And it's a 20% more, as we said. So Rabbi Yossi hold, since he live in Tzipori, and he hold that that's the measurement, which is 20% more. He hold that the eggs, at the time the Jewish people were in the desert, were bigger than the eggs they have at that time in Tzipori. And in order to fix that's different, you have to add some measurement to our eggs. And it's basically 120 to each eggs. And Rashi and Tosfot here elaborated that. So which means the nefach, the measurement, it can change. And the question remains, how much? So basically, if you go by the way it, well, at the end of the shiur, we'll bring the Chatam Sofer, etc. What's the bottom line? But just to give you just a small point of application to our times, you ask a question: since we don't have a Beit HaMikdash, how come we still have a Frashat Chala? As you know, the Mishnah, which we're going to study, but we read it every Friday night, those who daven Nusach Ashkenaz. So in the second chapter, Bameh Madlikin, there is a Mishnah. Mishnah number 6 there said, for three things, women die when they deliver their childbirth. You remember that Mishnah? Mm-hmm. Remember? Al Shenam Zirot, because they're not careful, in the Nidah, in the Afrashat Chalah, Tie for the Chala, and Al-Lakat Aner. Not careful in the lighting candles. So you see the second one is the issue that they need to have a portion of Rashat Chala. Now, how it works? You ask yourself, since we don't have the Beit HaMikdash, we don't know who is the real Kohen. So, what's the point in Rashat Chala? The answer is very related to what we study. The sages hold that as long as the Beit HaMikdash is not existed yet, God willing, soon will be rebuilt, but so far we don't have Beit HaMikdash, we all, which call Bechezkat Tmeim, which means we all under the definition of impure. Because you remember that impurity, meaning that you touch and attach, etc., let's say, example, the Chevra Kadisha, you remember, and you go and you touch a dead body, and then you touch another person, you hug another person, right? You touch another entity. So it's so we all bechezkat meim. So therefore, if you touch the chala, the dough, What happened is, as we said yesterday, you remember we talk about grandpa and father and grandson, you remember? We said that Avi Avot HaTumah, the grandpa, is, for example, what is Avi Avot HaTumah? Something that we call in Sabbai, grandfather. We said that that's applied to dead body. And then we say Av HaTumah, the father, something that is a derivative from Avi Avot HaTumah, which can be anyone who touch. And then we mentioned yesterday, if someone is impure, he duck in the water, just regular water, and he's all wet, and he touched something else, that person became also wet, and he touched another one, he will become wet, etc. You need to have maybe three stages until you touch someone and you still, you're no longer wet. So with that in mind, since we all bechezkat meim, we all under the category of most probably or basically impure, therefore we have the issue of touching that bread. So because of that, in order to avoid a situation that the bread will not be able to be eaten, we have to slice a portion and do what? What do you do with the Fashat Chala? After you make the bracha, what?
Burn it!
Furthermore, if you pay attention, when I watch these people who are baking Chala, we have to do, which if you see on the Kashrut, you see always it's written, Hufresha Chala Kadin, that they put a portion of the Chala according to the way it should be done. What does that mean? By Halakha, you are forbidden to eat challah, even they use the best ingredient, the kosher ingredient, and everything was made according to halakha. But if they did not do the tightening, the afrashat challah, we are forbidden to eat it. So you need to have afrashat challah. How much? So we said here, so far, is according to the measurement. So far we said, originally speaking, we talk about kave mechza. Now you see the machloket, it's chamisha revaim kemach. That's the machloket between Chachamim and Rabbi Yossi. Okay, because the measurement changed in about 20% between the tzipori, the midot Yerushalmiot, and the midot of the midbar. So far, so good. So that, all of that, is the first disputation between Shammai and Hillel. Second one, Ve'idach, again this is a Mishnah in Tractate Adayot. The next one, Hillel Omer, Melo Hin Maim Shuvim Poslim Et HaMikveh. As you know, that we need to have a drawing water for Mikveh. So he said that Melo Hin, a full hin of mine shuvin. So that's if you have the drawing water and is exceeded more than the 12. So Rashi said that it's not a mikveh anymore. The amount has to be in that measurement, which means when you prepare, you have to have certain time type of the raining water, and then you have the drawn water. So we said that Chayav Adam Lomar Bilshon Rabo. So Hillel Poter Halacha. But he brought it on the name of his Rebbe, which is Shmayav Avtalion. What's the problem with Shmayav Avtalion? Shmayav Avtalion is a convert, the convert to Judaism. So the Rambam tells us that when he used the word Hin, sometimes they have issue of mispronunciation. And therefore, it's possible that they meant ein, which is no, it's a different measurement. So, because of that, it's a it was not so simple. Rashi said here something very important. Rashi used the word klomar. Shechayav adam klomar hin, Eina leshon Mishnah, ela leshon Torah. So he said here, what does that mean? Rashi say the word klomar, he has a problem. Why are we using that the person needs to say what he heard from his Rebbe? Why we need to say it? So Rashi said, klomar hin enor mishom mishna ela leshon Torah. So Rashi said that the whole idea in the Mishnah is to explain to us what is hin. Hin is like ein. So Maharatz Chayot said the name of Gra that it's the way that it's resonating in the ear. It's very different than the measurement in the Torah. I recommend it. I have a long explanation in my book on Rashi. If you have the time, you should read. But anyway, the whole discussion here, it's because it was misconstrued, or because the measurement of the Torah is much bigger. So Shammai Omer Tish'a Kabin, which means that if you have a drawing water, that it's a measurement of Tish'a Kabin, that is basically 36 logim, that's already make the mikveh invalid. Why? Because he said, if you remember when we discuss a Brachot 22, so we have there the whole idea that Tish Alugim, it's enough to purify a Baal Keri, someone who have a discharge. So as long as it's enough to wash his body, it's good. So therefore we say that that's the amount that can make the mikveh invalid, because in order to make it invalid, you have to have the measurement of someone who can use it for ducking in the water. In other words, if it's below that measurement, it's not going to work. And then v'chachamim omrim, lo kedibrei ze, velo kedibrei ze. The sages say that it's neither one, neither according to Shammai nor to Hillel. But because they're not 100% sure what is the correct one, so that matter was still in doubt. Ad shebau shnei gardiyim mishar ha'ashpa shebirushalayim. The Gardiyim is the two people that say the two weavers. They came from the dung of the grave. That's a place that if you go to Yerushalayim, you see that that's the place that you collect all the the stuff. It's not. But these people, they came out and they said ve'idu mishum shmaya v'avtalion sheshlosha lugim ma'im shuvim poslim tamikveh. So they came and they testified in the name of Shmanya and Avtalion, that three lugins of drawn water disqualify the mikveh, and the kikmu chachamim medivrem, and the sages endorsed their words. So why they use, by the way, gardiyim? So the Gemara said in Kiddushim that was the lowest level of job. In other words, it's like garbage collector. They nowadays they don't call them garbage collector, they call it sanitary engineers, no? Or something like that. You know, it's like they said, a Jewish mother, she never said my son is driving a truck. She said that it's a big trucking business, and he is high above, and he is driving the wheel, and she never said that he's driving the wheel. He is but that was the lowest level of job. It's called gardiyim. They don't appoint from them neither a high priest nor a king. And that place, the Shar Ashpot, was the Ashpa in Hebrew, meaning the trash area, right? But these people, some said that they are trustworthy, that those people who came and they testified. And according to Halacha, they accepted them. But not everyone go along with them. The Rambam wasn't in that opinion, etc. Next one, the third one that the Shammai and Hillel disagree, ve'idach, against Mishnah both in Eduyot and Nida, Shammai omer kol anashim dayan she'atan, which means any woman that see the time of the Nida. So we don't go retroactively and say that if she touched Aharot, that it make it invalid, because remember, when we talk about, again, grandfather, father, grandson, you remember? Avi Avot HaTuma, Av HaTuma, Rishon, Sheni, Shlishi LeTuma, remember we talk about it? So, Isha Nida, a woman that is Nida, in addition to her prohibition of attachment to her husband, she's also in the level of Tum'ah, it's called Ava Tum'ah. And Ava Tum'ah, we explained yesterday, Ava Tum'ah attach person, Adam Vekelim, person or utensils, and make it Rishon Tum'ah, remember? So that's the idea of, so, Dayan Shatan, but you don't go retroactively, you go from that very moment. Ve'ilel Omer, Hillel disagree, and he said, no, mipkida lepkida, which means that they are declared tameh retroactively from the last examination to the present examination. So it's a huge difference. Which means, if she sees blood, but that blood was earlier, so any taharot she touched, according to Hillel, it's become tameh. In other words, if she checks herself and she's fine, and then a week later it turned not, so anything that happened between the two periods, retroactively, it's impure, it's tameh. Why? Because it may happen right after the first time she checked. Ve'afilu li'amim arbe, even it was relatively many days since the last time she checked. V'chachamim umrim, לא חדיברי זה ולא חדיברי זה, אלא מעט לעט ממעט, על יד מפקידה לפקידה, ומפקידה לפקידה ממעט. So the sages, in our language, it looks like the compromise, but they said neither according to Shammai, nor Hillel, rather we say that the period of one full day produced the time of retroactive tamet to less than for examination to examination, which means that Aliyad Me'et Le'et, since we were concerned that those Taharot become impure since she touched them, but it was just Me'et Le'et, which means that is the period of 24 hours before she see it, or something Taharot that she touched the since last time. So if it was 24 hours, it's fine, but in between the time, mipkida lepkida, it make it impure. So that's again that the third one, the third machloket between Hillel and Shammai, and we go by the sages. Vetu leika. So now the Gemara asks, is that's the only machloket? Is the only disputation between Hillel and Shammai ve'aika? We said in Gemara in Chagiga, page 17, Hillel omer lismoch, v'Shammai omer lo lismoch. When they brought the korbanot on Yontev, so during the day, the week, let's say Gil is going to Beit HaMikdash, he bring with him an offering. So you need to place your hand on the offering, and you need to say certain things. Now, if it's a neder, if it's an oath, or nedava, it's a voluntary contribution, during the festival, like Yom Tov, so it's a dispute between the Tanaim, what you should do. In Yom Tov, individual korban yachid, individual korban, when you place your hands on the animal, all right? So it's a rabbinic decree that said that since he may, it's called in Ivrit, Shema Itlosh Anaf, that is chashash, that he may be take part or do, so they said that on... the rabbi said that you cannot place your hand on the animals on the Yom Tov. So, what you have to do? So it's called techef lasmicha shchita. You have to do it before Yom Tov, and that way you can do it there. So Hillel hold that you should do it the same as a regular day. You should place your hand on the korbanot. Shammai said no, you can't do it. That's, by the way, only to individuals, not to the public korban. But just for practical halacha, nedarim and nedavot, it's not offering on yontev. And therefore, here they speak only in a shalmei chagiga, olat reiya, things like that. So how come? So the Gemara responded and said, ki kama Rav Una. When Rav Una said that they only three cases that they are, disagree, heicha delega leka plukta de rabvata be'adayu. That's only where is a no dispute of other great men together with them, which means that only Shammai and Hillel, they are only people that disagree, and it's only three places. But if you have others, that's different. How? Ve'aika. So they said there is another dispute between them, which is habotzer legat, if someone harvests grapes for the wine press in order to make it wine. Shammai, remember a few sessions ago we talked about gat, that is special winery place that they... Shammai omer uchshar, the grape is ready to receive tuma, because there's a little wine coming out when they at that process. V'ilel omer lo uchshar. So why Rav Una said it's only three places? So they responded, bar minei de'ai, that case is excluded. The hatam kashatikile l'shamay. Over there, Hillel was quiet. It's like he was acquiesce. He was agreed that, in other words, he back off his idea that he agreed with Shammai. So that's the reason why I didn't mention. Now, since we back to our subject with the 18, so we elaborate of different decrees by the rabbis. Yosef ben Yoezer ish Tzrida, v'Yosef ben Yochanan ish Yerushalayim, gazru tum'a al eretz ha'amim. These two of the pair, you read it in the Ethics, in the Mishnayot of the Birkei Avot, you put a decree of tum'a for land of the nations, v'al klei zchuchit, and also that glass utensils, they also accept tuma. So they said, this is much earlier. It was the rabbis that we call 80 years, which is those rabbis who live 80 years before the destruction of the second Beit HaMikdash. These are the people who make that the decree. Amar Rav Kahana, Rav Kahana said, "Kshechala Rabbi Yishmael v'Rabbi Yossi shalchu lo." When Rabbi Yishmael v'Rabbi Yossi was sick, the sages sent to him and said, "Rabbi, emolnu shnayim u'shlosha darim shamarnu mishum avicha. Tell us two or three things that you heard from your father." Shalach lahem kach, amar Rabbi, said to them, that's what my dad said. 180 shana ad shelo charav habayit. It's 180 years before the destruction of Second Temple. Pashta malchut, which is the Rome kingdom, harsha al Israel, the evil Rome kingdom, and the occupation begins. 80 shana ad shelo charav habayit. It was 80 years until the temple destroyed. Gazru tuma le'eretz ha'amim al klei zchuchit. At that time, they put the decree of the nation impurity and also the utensils that glass. 40 shana ad shelo charav habayit, 4 years until the temple destroyed. Galtala Sanhedrin, so which means the rabbinic high rabbinical court were moved from the place, it's called Lishkad Gazit in the Mikdash, to where Vyashvala Bachanuyot. Chanuyot is a place in the Temple Mount. That was his name. Its name is Chanuyot. That's Rashi said. It's like they see already what's coming soon. So you see here that the decree of the nations and the glass utensils, it was 8 years earlier, not at that time. So lemay elcheta. So why Rabbi Yossi said that they move? Amar Rabbi Yitzchak bar Avdim lemar shushlodu mitnei knasot, which is it was a different. A discussion, court session. One of them, it's a penalty laws. So penalty laws, it's a rabbinic. It's rabbinic knesot, but you need to have a mumchim, you need to have an expert to have a trial, to have a judgment in that. So the ne knesot sarkadatach. Do you mind to say that they stop making any type of penalty law? because penalty law, you can make a judgment any place. You don't need to have the it's not related to the Moshava Sanhedrin, whatever the sages seat. Because the Lishkat HaGazit is not the one who make this type of penalty laws. That's the Sanhedrin, they said it. So, Elaima Shelo Danu Dine Nefashot. They said that the Sanhedrin did not judge cases involving what? In capital cases. Capital cases, no. Why? Because by Halacha, even you need to have it in a Beit Din HaGadol, in a high court, any Beit Din basically can have 23 judges and do it, but they do it only when the high Sanhedrin sitting in their place, which is the Lishkat HaGazi. Why the Torah said in Dvarim, in Deuteronomy chapter 17, Ve'asita kechol asher yiruha, you should do what they tell you, min ha-makom ahu, in that particular place. Which means, we learn from that, in the Tractate Avodah Zarah, it said, Magid sha-makom gorem, that the place that they are, have the session is crucial. So you need to have it in a place that Lishkat HaGazi is in Jerusalem in order to make a capital cases of death penalty. So maybe you said that this pair live at that time. We're like today in a history session. Maybe it's a Tanya Hillel v'Shimon v'Gamliel v'Shimon nagu nisutam lifnei habayit mea shana. Hillel became a nasi 100 years before the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash. And then it was his son, Rabban Shimon. And then it was Rabban Gamliel. Yosef ben Yoeser, Yitzredav, Yosef ben Yochanan, have a kadme tuva. As you read in Pirkei Avot, chapter 1, they live much earlier. So now you tell me that the sages made it, this decree of the Eretz Amim and the glasses. Maybe it's the Yosef ben Yoeser. So now we're in a 15b. Ella, it was two stages when they make that the decree, the rabbinic decree. It's not that they reconcile, it's just want to explore on that. One at the time of Yosei, and then it was the second Yosei, that it's 8 years early time, it's two different times. Atehinu, which is Yosei and Yosei, Ugzu Agusha, and lisrof vaavira velo chlum. Okay, so they have a special decree that the tuma on the cloud of earth from the lands of the nations. So they hold that he hold the impurity, which means, in that sense, if it's in the non-Jewish land, the whole the rule of impurity. However, ve'avira ve'lo klum, but the decree of the airspace of the nation, they didn't put any. So it means that if you have a truma that that enter to the airspace of other nation than Eretz Israel, but it doesn't touch the afar, the ground. So it's not considered tuma. But then the sages who come later, they put a decree that it's also the airspace. Part of that. So I don't want to go too deep here because we're running out of time. But it's a very large discussion over this issue of safek. It's safek meaning you have a doubt. Rabbi Kiva Iger deal a lot with sfek sveka mitapech, which is doubt within the doubt and within the doubts. So it's a big question how far you go and when you forbids to eat, but it's above the scope of this discussion. So the Gemara asks, Lememra dechad agzerta havel isreifa. So what do you understand? That one decree to consign the truma to burning. Va'amar ilfa. Ilfa said, "Yadayim tchilat gzeratan lesrefa," which means that hence the original decree that was burning, which means because you touch, you have to burn. What we said about hafrashat challah, for example, you're touching, you're impure, So you need to burn, okay? Yadayim hu letchilat gzeratam lisrefa. In the hands, that's the beginning to burn. Hamidi achrin alo, but other things no. Ela atuhinu, beginning Yossi and Yossi. So they decreed a tuma on the cloth on earth from the lands of the nations that you need to burn. It's a spent tuma that come into contact with it. But the airspace, they said that it's nothing. Because they, when the Sanhedrin dwell in the Usha, it was a long time after the destruction, which means 10 minutes after the 10 times after the destruction, the Sanhedrin moved from one place to another. So Sadik Mar and Rosh Hashanah said it. So one of them, it's called Usha, which is in Galilee, and many decrees they made there. So one of the things they made is the Tumat Eretz Amim. Ditnan, we said in the Mishnah in Taharot, Al Shisha Sfekot Sofim Et HaTruma. That's something mechudash, that's something new that they learn over there. That six different situation, cases of you have a doubt over Tuma, one must burn the Truma. Which one? Number one, Al Sfek Bet HaPras, if it's a field, you have a grave there. And since you have a grave, anything that enter there, it's a question of tum'ah. And because it's called etzem ma'ahil, if it's a little bone left there, even that is a level of se'ora, it's a level of a very like small weed. But the problem is, if you step on that, it's like an ohel. It's a issue that it may be contaminated in that sense. So the Sadish said, even you don't know it's a large field, but you know that it's a grave, but you don't know. So they said that it's like a definite impure, it's like a definite corpse area. So if someone enter there with the Truma, what you have to do? You have to burn it. It's called Safek Beit HaPras. You're not sure, so you make it like it's. You have to burn the Truma. Why? Because it's connected with something impure. And again, Rashi here explained with Kelomar, and I recommended you to read my book, explanation what is all the details of Safek Beit HaPras. Number two, Val Safek Afar Abba Meretz Amim, we just explained it, that the dust that came from the land of the nation, Val Safek Bigdei HaMaaretz. So someone who's not educated, so his wife may be sit or darsa, or maybe step on when she was impure. And since Amaris doesn't know the halachot, so we put a decree. Rashi explained one way, Tosfot explained differently, but they basically that you have to burn that truma. Val safek hakelim hanimtzaim, on the account that the doubtful of truma that utensil have found. And then val safek harukim, an account of doubtful truma that spitted that found, val safek miragle adam, an account of foot of human urine, so shekeneged miragle beema, that it's in the proximity of animal urine, so any type of urine that they put truma, that because people who have discharged like zavin zava, the urine that come out of them, it's already impure. And even you find it close to animals, even they come from pure animals, it's two doubts, shtei sfekot. It's one, it's if it's come of men or for animals, that even it come from men, it's question if it's come from men who's pure or not pure. So they, since it's a sfek sfeka, so they put a decree of tuma, and you have to burn it. Al vadai maga'an val shu sfek tumuatan. And for definite contact of this item tuma, and which consists to a case of doubtful tuma, so fimet truma, one must burn the truma. It's like tumat vadai, it's like you're sure that is tuma. Even that is it's a big question, and regardless is a public place or private place. Rabbi Yossi disagree. Rabbi Yossi omer al safek magan b'yushut echid sofim truma. He said, only one burned the tumah on account of doubtful contact with this item in a private domain. But if it's in a public domain, it's different and not. And v'chachamim omrim, and the sages said, ברשות היחיד תולים, ואמר אולה, ברשות הרבים תאורים, ברשות היחיד תולים, ברשות הרבים תאורים, ואמר אולה, אלו שישה ספיקות באושה תקנו. So that's the six ספיקות they made in אושה. אלה, so the three stages in the ארץ הרבים, אתו הינו, יוסי אין יוסי, גזו הגושה לתלות באוויר על ולא כלום, they put the decree in the גושה, that's come from the Eretz Tumah Ta'amim, and two, ועתו רבן שמונים שנה גזו אידי ואידי לתלות, and the sages of the 8 years before the destruction put in both, in the earth space and the dust, ועתו באושה גזו הגושה לשרוף, and the אושה add, and they said that you need to burn it if you touch it, ועבירה דקדקאי, and the air, they kept it as airspace. They no new stringencies, and the existing degree stays as it was, which is suspend tumah. Kav umechza chayav bechala. So we said 1.5 kav is obligated to chala, and we explained that the law of chala that you have to put it tight. So it's written in the Torah in Book of Numbers, chapter 15. One is required to separate a small part of the dough as a gift to the Kohen. However, the Torah neither specify the measure of the dough, which is gift must be separated, nor the size of the gift. So as a rule, the measure of dough from which challah must be separated is dependent on the measure of the Omer, the daily ration of the manna in the time of the desert, which is the tenth of Eifah. However, we followed the Tosfot that said that there is a dispute in regard to that matter. Some explained the dispute between Shammai and Hillel. It's a the measurement of the egg bag. But basically, if we go in our language, the way that they said kavo mechza, so you just measure a part, a small part at the top. Some say that it's like the measurement we said at 24, 48, 36 of egg bag. Which is the at least kav umechza, two kavs. That's a person need to slice that part and burn it. That's the afreshat chala. Otherwise, we cannot eat the chala. Chayav adam lo arishon b'agobo. A person must speak employing the language of his teacher. So the Rambam said in the commentary of the Mishnah that it's important to mention the name of Rav. By the way, I forgot to say that the when it's come to the measure of the dough, any measure, it's fine as long as it's a measure, as long as it's something. In other words, we always measure something, but we don't exaggerate. You don't need to slice one-third of the challah and burn it. You take a small part and you burn it. That's what I meant. Another halacha, it's shlosha lugim mayim shuvim posim dam gevur. There are three logs of drawn water. This qualified the mikveh, the ritual bath, the three logs of drawn water that falls into a ritual bath that is less than 40 se'ah. This qualified the ritual bath. So imagine if you have a raining water and you have too much drawing water. So so the Rambam said in Hot Mikveot chapter 4 that that's make it. Mematay tumat nida, when does the menstruating women become impure? A woman who does not have a fixed period and saw a blood flow, but did not feel it begins to flow the impure only 24 hours retroactively. If she examines herself within the period, she is retroactively impure from the time of the examination. That's the opinion of the rabbis that said earlier. And last thing that we study today, it was the Tumat Eretz Amim, which is the impurity of the land of the nations. So the sages decree that anything, person or vessels that come in contact with or carries the soil become impure of the 7 days, like the law of purification. And we said because of that there is a lot of question involved with burial, etc. So they left it up there. One of the issue of impurity is the glass vessels. Although glass vessels do not become impure by Torah law, the sages decree that they become impure. So basically, the glass vessel is a long subject. When it's come to Pesach, for example, and other things, a different opinion between Sfaradim and Ashkenazim, and we, Mitzvah Hashem, will discuss it in the near future. Hashem.